At the core of linear algebra are two different operations, two different ways that we can construct new vectors out of old vectors. The first of them was vector addition, and this said if you had two different vectors, that you could do a sort of tip-to-tail addition of them. And the second of them was scalar multiplication, which says that if you've got one vector, that you can go and multiply its length by a scalar, say, for example, you could multiply it by a factor of 2. And then everything else that we did in linear algebra, whether we were talking about linear combinations, whether we were talking about linear independence, whether we were talking about spans, whether we were using matrices, all of that was just almost a different way to codify and keep track of these two different fundamental operations. Now, this was the geometric way at looking at these different operations, but there was also an algebraic way. We could say, for example, that if you had two different vectors defined algebraically as lists of numbers, that was how you added them, and this was how you multiplied them by a scalar. Now, these operations, whether they were algebraic or whether they were geometric, they obeyed a list of rules. There was one that we covered already in the videos. This was the idea of commutivity of vector addition. It says that I can multiply it either way. For example, we've seen geometrically that there was this nice picture where you sort of had this parallelogram, and you could add the two vectors in either way, and you got to the same spot. It didn't matter what the order of the vector addition was. You could prove the same kind of rule algebraically as well. Now, this is one rule, but it turns out there's actually an enormous list of rules. All of these different rules are obeyed by the vectors, and you could go through and you could check whether geometrically or algebraically all these rules made sense. They're sort of categorized in the first bunch of them are rules to do with adding things, commutivity and associativity, the idea of having a zero vector that you could add to something that doesn't change it. The next bunch were more related to scalar multiplication or how you might distribute scalar multiplication over vector addition. And then the final two are kind of funny. The final two down here, those ones are kind of obvious in Rn. They're just saying, look, if you take two n vectors and you add them together, then what you get is just another n vector. It also lives in Rn. Or if I multiply it by 2, it also lives in Rn. And to be clear, this list of rules applies for every single vector. No matter what the u, the v, the w is inside of Rn, no matter what the scalars c and d are, all of these rules have to be obeyed. By the way, the yellow ones, the zero vector, the one scalar, and for every vector, the negative of that, this is sort of an existence claim. It says there exist these special vectors like the zero vector and the one scalar that are part of these list of rules. Now, here's the key point. After I've made this list of rules, which vectors in Rn obey all those rules, I can abstract this concept. For example, are there other things out there, other things in math world somewhere that also obey the same list of 10 rules? Here we've put Rn in, but maybe instead of the specific Rn, I'm just going to put V for vector space. Is there some other sets that you have other operations that are analogous to vector addition and scalar multiplication that also obey these lists of 10 rules? So a vector space is just some non-empty set. We don't really care about the empty set, it's sort of silly. It's a non-empty set that you have these two different operations, vector addition and scalar multiplication, and then they obey the entire list of 10 rules. Now, the nice part about this is that we're developing linear algebra in this course, primarily in Rn. Everything we're doing, every vector space we're seeing is really just Rn. And we're developing all of these tools and ideas about Rn. But the point is, because they all came from the two different operations that obey this list of rules, any other vector space, which may not be consisting of vectors, it may consist of some other things, but as long as you can define these two different operations and they obey those 10 rules, everything we've developed in this course carries over into those new domains as well. So while we are doing linear algebra on Rn, most of what we're doing applies to linear algebra on arbitrary vector spaces, V, obeying these list of rules. So let me give you one example. Let me give you an example of a vector space that is not Rn, that looks different from Rn, but is nonetheless a vector space and nonetheless obeys this list of rules, and where most of the analysis of linear algebra applies in this context as well. So the example I'm going to give you is polynomials of degree less than or equal to n. Things like 1 plus x squared plus x to the fourth. Okay, so that's my set. My set are polynomials. But I have to define a scalar multiplication and a vector addition. So let me just put an example. This is here is a element, is a quote-unquote vector in this vector space. It's just a polynomial. I've got this 1, I've got this 3x, and I've got this minus x squared. It's a polynomial. In this case, we're talking about polynomials of degree less than or equal to 2. Now, I can go and multiply this by a scalar. Let me go and take this whole thing, and I'm going to multiply it by some scalar. How about the scalar 2? We know how multiplication of polynomials works. You just go and take all the factors, you multiply them by 2, and what do you get? You get 2 plus 6x minus 2x squared. So this is a definition of scalar multiplication. It's a way that you multiply polynomials. What about addition? Well, let me suppose I've got a polynomial here, and then I add to it a different polynomial. Note that 3 plus 2x squared is still a polynomial of degree less or equal to 2. There's no x term there, but you might want to think of it as 0 multiplied by x. Well, I'm quite able to add these two things. I can just add them component by component. The 1 and the 3 are my constant terms. They add up to 4. The 3x and the 0x add up to 3x, and the minus x squared and the 2x squared add up to 1x squared. So what do you get? You get an addition defined here, and we get an answer for the addition of these two polynomials. Now, to truly prove that this is a vector space, I have to take these operations and I have to prove that they obey the list of 10 different rules. I'm not going to do that. You can pick one or two and prove that indeed this definition does satisfy this. But regardless, what we get is a new vector space where a vector doesn't look like the geometric arrow we've seen before. The vector looks like a polynomial. Heck, even in what we have done, we've always talked about there being the two sides, the geometric and the algebraic, but in a sense, really what we have is two different vector spaces. The algebraic side, where a vector means a list, a column of different numbers, and you add them component by component, but geometrically, we had them as these little arrows that you could move around and you could add them tip to tail. In essence, what we're really saying here is that this notion where vectors are this geometric thing, where you're adding things tip to tail, and these notion of vectors where they're this algebraic thing, a column of numbers, these are two different vector spaces. And then we've noticed that there's a connection between them. You can sort of have a correspondence where one vector and the one vector space is interpreted in terms of the other vector space. So while they're two different vector spaces in their presentation, indeed there is some sort of equivalency between them. Now, the fact that we've managed to generalize the idea of vector spaces is going to be incredibly important when it comes more to the application side of things. When you're doing all kinds of interesting things like Fourier analysis and quantum mechanics, and you're playing around in color spaces, a lot of these different things all out throughout engineering and through physics and through science, it turns out that there's a lot of vector spaces, or at least things that are pretty close to vector spaces floating around. So in linear algebra, we're working in Rn, we're developing our skills in Rn, but what we're really going to do in a lot of applications is we're going to interpret some application as being a vector space. And because they obey the same rules that linear algebra in Rn does, we can take the ideas of linear algebra in Rn and extend them into these different domains.